Good morning and welcome to Ely Gospel Church. Special welcome to you on Facebook and later on YouTube. If you want to know what we're all about, go to elygospel.com. And you'll find out that we're a Bible-believing church. Let's open a word of prayer this morning. First and foremost, Lord, we thank you for everything you do every day. I don't know where we'd be if you weren't looking out for us, Lord. Lord, I'd ask that you would give safety to those that are traveling. Jake and Josh as they go climb a mountain. Lord, that you would keep the volume in our town here so that the businesses, outfitters, restaurants could make back some of what they lost during the COVID time. And I thank you for the volume. I thank you for the congestion in the streets, Lord. It just means that lots of people are here. We thank you. Be with our leaders, Lord. Both elected and appointed. Cause them to see the truth and to act accordingly. I ask this in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Amen. Let's praise the Lord this morning. Take a little trip over to Rhineland earlier this week and get to see our grandchildren. He'll be on the motorcycle. Let's praise the Lord this morning.
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Yeah. is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of
in a moment we shall be changed. when we all
Yeah.
Oh.
Church once again in beautiful Ely, Minnesota. So there's a couple things I want to just bring up this morning. I do a lot of reading, and I came across this one, something that somebody wrote. How's that? I don't even, it wasn't like a quote, but it was part of the reading that I was studying. And it says when we, and so there's a couple things I'm going to pray for as I go through this, and it'll be short. But it says when we host the presence of God, and we do that when we come here Sundays and whenever, and welcome the Holy Spirit here. So when we host the presence of God, heaven comes down, and there is no sickness in heaven. So I want to pray for those that are here and watching on a screen, for anybody that has any sickness or ailments in their body. And Lord, I just want to bring that up, and that you would bring a healing here, Lord, because we do call upon your Holy Spirit, and your presence is here, Lord. And while your presence is here, we are with you. And we thank you, Lord, that you've come here always, Lord. And now we ask that your healing hand would be upon anybody and everybody that has any ailment in their body, Lord, and that there would be a miraculous healing through your hand. And I do want to bring up, yesterday my wife fell and off of a three-stool chair and caught her foot up in the back of it and twisted her ankle and her knee and banged up her shoulder, and that's why she's not here today. So I want to bring her up. And Lord, I just do ask that since there is no sickness and there's no injury in heaven, Lord, and it won't be here in this day in this church, Father, I just ask that you would heal my bride with all of her injuries, Lord, and bring her to a complete turnaround and healing, Lord, and quickly is what we ask. And we thank you that you watch over her, Lord, and that you love her, Lord, and that you are attentive and that you will heal her, Lord. We have that expectation because your word says so, in Jesus' name. So then it went on to say there's no poverty in heaven, so we can trust the Lord with everything. Call up for healing, call up for finances, call up for our spiritual growth, call up for any need that you may have. Because also it goes on to say there's no lack in heaven. And if there's no lack in heaven, when we call upon the presence of the Holy Spirit and he is about us, there's no lack here as well. And we need to really believe that. We're sealed with the Holy Spirit, those of us and all of us that are born again. The Bible tells us he seals us with the Holy Spirit, and therefore we are. And we need to trust the Lord in every aspect of our life. It doesn't matter what it is, no matter what it is. So, Father, we invite the presence of your Holy Spirit and your kingdom into this place today, Lord. And I thank you that you've given our pastor, Tim, the long view, the love he has in your heart for you, Lord, and for your word. And thank you that he is in the word all the time, it seems like. And Father, we just thank you for blessing that time that you give them to study, and just not to study, but just to meditate on your word, Lord, because that reflects this congregation. That reflects into our hearts. And Lord, we just thank you that you gave him a purpose in his sermon this morning that will be able to be applied to each one of us on some level, no matter what it is. And all of the sermons are that way. When we look deep enough, Lord, we can apply them all somewhere, because it's your word and it's your love for us. And we thank you, Lord, that you left this love letter behind for us to study as well. And now if the ushers would come forward, please. Father, we thank you for this offering this morning, Lord God, and we thank you that you look upon it with favor. Lord, we just thank you that we are part of this kingdom of growth, and it's a part of how you've established things to happen here on this earth, Lord, that more and more people would come to you, hear your word, and understand it, Lord. And we just thank you that this helps put Bibles in their hands. It helps them to come to understand who you are. And Lord, we just thank you that there's ones out in the field and in this congregation, Lord, that are in this community that touch other people's lives daily. And we just thank you for their faithfulness. And we thank you for yours. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Joyce has an announcement. too, so she can come up and then dismiss the children. Just a quick prayer on my end and one announcement. Again, I'm very willing to drive over to the Discovery Center today for the Iron Range Renewal prayer. Prayer and worship. And that's at the Discovery Center. If you want to go with me, meet here at 4:30 and we'll drive over together. If I do have someone that shows up, we'll stop down in Babbitt and pick someone up as well. But as of right now, I don't have anyone signed up. But just so you know, I'm still willing to do that. And Heavenly Father, for our vacationers, Lord, I pray our young families out vacationing, I pray, God, that you would grant them recreation and recreation. In fact, that's what I ask for all those that come to the North Country, for that time away. In fact, I ask that one day, Lord God, this entire Iron Range would be known more for recreation than recreation. And we thank you for the latter. But Lord, may it be that we are more known for what the Spirit of the living God is doing here in our place. Father, we ask in Jesus' name, amen. So Joyce, go ahead and then dismiss the kids too.
This coming Saturday is our missions fundraiser rummage sale. So donations will be accepted on Wednesday and Thursday. And let's just say from about 9 until 4, the church will be open. And if you could, please take your donations downstairs so that we don't have to haul it all down there, if you're able to. And then on Thursday, after the Women's Bible Study and Friday, we will be setting up downstairs and in a portion of the entryway only. So if you're able to help for any time at all, we will start after Ladies Bible Study and go for a few hours, and then Friday until everything is set up. And Saturday, the sale will be from 8 until 1, and if you are able to help for that, we would greatly appreciate it. If you have any questions, just ask me. Now, kids, we're going to go downstairs and learn some more about Jesus and talk about some of the Ten Commandments. So if everybody could rise up and at the count of three say what we say every single Sunday, I love you, Jesus. 1, 2, 3. I love you, Jesus.
Taking a break from Acts today, and I just had something thematic in my heart. I'll introduce it here in a moment. Heavenly Father, I want to depend on you more. Notes a little bit less. I want to do due diligence, but depend on notes a little bit less, a little bit more on you. Just a fresher, more communicative style. And I ask for grace today to communicate some things that I think are precious to you and that have been impressed upon me. How did the person say it today? How did Brianna say it? That they would land softly but with full effect upon our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys think about this for a second. When I ask you to think about God, what comes to mind for you? When I ask you to think about God, in fact, take a second. You maybe naturally do it by virtue of the question. What do you think about? Think about when someone asks you to think about God, or when God comes to mind. If I'm honest about that, and some of it's unique to my role, but a lot of times when I'm asked to think about God, I end up thinking about, and I just wrote a few things down, and hear me out. But when my goal is in some sense to think about God, I end up thinking about missions. And sometimes when I'm wanting to think about God, I end up thinking about evangelism. Instead, sometimes when I'm thinking about God, or want to be thinking about God, I quickly drift off into, I need to love and serve others. I think about godly pastoring. I think about godly husbanding. I think about godly parenting. I think about godly neighboring. I think about godly workering. I think about people that need healed hearts and healed bodies, healing in all its forms. I think about fellowship. I think about true Christian unity that is full of both grace and truth. The point is, so often when asked to think about God, or when taking time aside to think about God, or spending some time in a quiet time, I call it a godly pursuit, and yet sometimes God himself is the point. God himself is the one thing I don't think about. I think about things related to God. I think about things pertaining to God, and that's not bad. That's not bad. But all those things I mentioned play out on a horizontal level. And there's still a vertical dimension. There's still a, I forget what those are called. There's a vertical axis. There's a vertical axis that's meant for God and for him alone. And no, and with all our human doing, play that metaphor, with all our human doing on the horizontal axis, there's a place for us to be a human being just before him. Amen. To be still and to know that he is God. Partly, I guess, what I was trying to get at is that so often when the idea is to set myself before my God and Father, or my God and Savior and Lord, or to commune in fellowship with the Holy Spirit, I end up thinking about things on the horizontal plane. And I don't end up thinking about them in themselves, in their person, in their godness. I guess what I wanted to say is that Abraham had everything going for him. He had promises galore. But the ultimate promise he received, and I think it's the greatness of his life ultimately, is that God said to him something so amazing. He said, your kids, your legacy will be like the sand of the seashores, or will be like the sands. He said, you're not only the father of many or a multitude, he said, you'll be the father of many nations. I mean, just that I'm going to give you a land flowing with milk and honey. And just the promises, and that I'll be with you, and that you'll bear a child in old age, and all the things. But that he said this, he said, but I'm your exceeding great reward. Abraham, above all those other things, don't ever forget that I myself am your exceeding great reward. And so really this sermon has now been said. I'm going to detail it out with a few things. But the simple point was to say, in all you're getting, get God. Get God himself. And not just the things of God, if that makes sense. Another way that I thought I could say it is this. I mean, because I'm ultimately contending for intimacy with the Lord, which is really a theme that the Lord has pressed upon me. I could refer you back to Revelations chapter 2, verses like 1 through 5 in there, but it's the resume of the Ephesians, that they were zealous over you know, they were zealous to confront false prophets and false teachers. They had not grown weary, that they had labored hard for the Lord. I forget all the things, but you've heard me mention before, it's a sterling resume. Like when you just read the resume part, it's like, man, I'd love to go to heaven with that resume and then say, what is this? You know, what rewards are equal to this resume? And then the Lord just pulls the carpet out from under it and says, but I have this against you. You forgot about me. You forgot about your first love. You're forsaking your first love. The depths are the heights from which you have fallen. Just the provocative language there. Another way that I could say it is this, contending for something that Job said in chapter 42, verse 5. And this is a little bit the thing. So often I think our thoughts of God are on one level instead of another level. But here's the statement that Job said. He said, I'd heard of you. He was considered one of the most righteous men on the face of the earth. But he himself then said of his testimony in that state, I've heard of you with the hearing of the ears. I thought I knew you. I thought I knew you thoroughly, completely, fully, intimately. But I heard of you with the hearing of the ears. But what I've just been through, now my eyes see. Now I see. And so I was thinking of this idea of seeing the Lord, gazing. David said, one thing have I desired of the Lord. That will I seek after. David, children, wives, a kingdom, successful, military conquest. You know, when he finally came out of his troubles, he had his exploits with lions and bears and Goliath. But he said somehow he, for all his mistakes as well, but for somehow for all that, he was able to transcend. And the ultimate transcendence, Tom was teasing on Thursday, isn't that he transcended to the place of poet. Though there's something beautiful about the songs he's written, they'll never be equal. But what's really beautiful about David's life is that with all that other stuff, there was still something that was ultimately more important to him. And that's one thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord. When the Lord was physically present, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold or to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, his virtues, his excellencies, his character, his countenance, the fruit of his spirit, the totality of all that God is spiritual beauty. That I may gaze upon that and inquire in your temple. That's so beautiful that no amount of blessing was able to distract him from the ultimate, which is that God, for him too, was a very great reward. And so I've been just setting my heart to think, how do I practically try and get across this idea of seeing the Lord, of gazing upon the beauty of the Lord? Because it's really tough for us on a practical level. You see, practically speaking, nothing is more transformative. Nothing will ever be more transforming, sanctifying, holy-making, happy-making. To see the Lord is called in antiquity the happy-making sight. Like you can't not be happy gazing upon the Lord. They call it the beatific vision, the beautiful-making sight. But the trouble is that right now in this dispensation, the Bible says we see in a mirror dimly. like in an ancient mirror, like in a cheap camping mirror that doesn't give a perfect reflection, that gives a foggy reflection, that gives a wavy reflection, that gives a distorted picture. It's like not quite a carnival mirror, but it gives a distorted picture. But that was an ancient mirror, nowhere near the quality of the mirror that we have today. And yet we can tell it's Jesus, but it's not perfect. And it says, though we see in a mirror dimly, one day we'll see face to face. But I think sometimes we get discouraged with the dimness of that mirror. And it's not clear. And what's the use? And I know all this already. And there's a way that we, you know, kind of distance ourselves from pursuing the Lord and gazing upon His beauty. And we think, what? Let's just get busy doing this stuff. Let's just get busy doing the stuff, the ministry. It's so easy. It's so easy to put every ounce of energy into ministry and to not minister to the Lord. This seeing the Lord, seeing Him as beautiful, seeing Him as He truly is. My ears have heard of You, but now my eyes see. It affects every aspect of our salvation. So I'm contending for its practicality right now. But I just want you to see that the Bible uses language that kind of puts it in the sense of seeing or savoring the Lord. The idea of taste and see that the Lord is good. It gets a little bit past our Western mind sense into a sense of experiential, the experiential side of faithing or believing in the Lord. But we talk about it as our justification. We talk about it, it's not exactly the same, but we talk about justification, just as if we never sinned. We talk about that moment when we become a new creation, when our spirit is absolutely risen from the dead and made new. We talk about being born again. We talk about being born again. The Bible can frame up that whole situation, that whole experience, in the guise or in the sense of seeing the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. Of course, now I'm drawing a blank. Just a second. God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness." So it's making an appeal to the God, the creator, power of God from Genesis 1. The Genesis 1 God who said, "Let light, natural light, shine out of darkness." Only now it's talking about spiritual light. "Has shone in our hearts with spiritual light." He's shone in our hearts. He's given spiritual light. We, through the preaching of the word, through the evangelism of a friend, through reading that tract, through opening your Bible, it's light diffused. Spiritual light came into my heart. And it says, said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. What that's saying is that we can talk all we want, and it's true. "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" "Believe on the Lord Jesus and you will be saved." But for us, that's such a mental thing. That's such a decisional thing. There's another aspect in which we can talk about that in terms of seeing the Lord. It's the moment at which Jesus first became beautiful. Because if you grow up in Western culture, even if you're on church, Jesus, 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 Jesus. But there's something about that first time it clicks with light, with spiritual light. And it's like, Jesus, I get it. You are more than just a great person. You are more than just a great teacher. You are more than just a miracle worker. You're more than just one of the many great people of antiquity. You are truly God. You're God's son. You are Savior. You are Lord. You are everything, and you are beautiful, and you love even me. I believe, and I worship you. No, there's some sense in which we're never born again without experience or seeing the Lord spiritually as starkly and as dramatically as natural light came into the universe. It's as powerful and dramatic as spiritual light coming into the soul to see him as beautiful. And so the Bible talks about justification. The Bible uses language like this: you have been saved. It refers to our salvation in the past tense. That's justification. And it pertains specifically to the realm of our spirit. Do you know this? This is mind-blowing. You know, your spirit will not become more perfect in heaven. Your spirit is as perfect now as it will ever be. And isn't it a good thing? And you know you have the Spirit of God within you, because this is more than a conscience. Because the Spirit within you, it never agrees with sin. It never agrees with darkness. It never agrees with bitterness. It never agrees with hate. It never agrees with cutting corners. It never agrees with ungodliness. It is always, always for truth and grace and purity and holiness. And so that work in our spirit comes by seeing Jesus as spiritually beautiful, that he is ultimately Savior and he is Lord and he is God. What about the other senses of salvation? The Bible says not only that we have been saved, it says we're being saved. Well, wait, I thought I have been saved. Well, you have been, and you're also being saved. The Bible uses all these tenses. There's the work of our soul, the realm of our soul, our mind, our will, our emotions. We wouldn't say that's perfect yet, would we? No. It has attitudes sometimes that are less than pleasing to the Lord. It feels things sometimes with an intensity that is not holy passion. In any event, the Bible says that we're also being saved. We call that progressive sanctification. Progressive sanctification. The process of being made holy. The first part of our holiness is we're set apart to the Lord as holy. The second part of holiness is he actually progressively makes us holy or pure. But what about that process of becoming pure? Becoming holy, having the realm of our emotions, having the realm of our thinking, our mind, having that transformed by the renewal of your mind. How does that happen? Well, it happens by seeing the Lord as beautiful. It happens by seeing him as he really is. Now I would cite for you 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18. We all with unveiled face, there's no veil that we have to put up. We can gaze fully. We all with unveiled face, gazing upon the glory of the Lord, unveiled, are being transformed into the same image or glory from one degree to another. And how is that happen? How does our sanctification happen? How are we being made holy in the present? By continuing to gaze upon the Lord. By continuing to see him as beautiful. I'm spending too much time on these illustrations, so let me just quickly go to the future tense. The Bible says you have been saved, it says you're being saved, and it says you will be saved. A future tense to our salvation, and it's the work of our body. Would anyone say that our body has been saved? No, things still live in our members. And anytime you feel ouch, ouch is really just an echo of death. And that means our bodies are not being made perfect yet. But the Bible tells us as well, and it has to do with seeing 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. When we see him, we will be like him, for we'll see him as he is. That transformative in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, when he comes in his glory and he transforms our lowly body into what he calls his glorious body. Well, why isn't it just one and done? Why do we need to keep gazing? And why does it have to be with a certain amount of dimness? Why does it have to be in a mirror dimly? Why sometimes when I go to set my heart before the Lord, to be quite honest, why can it seem dry sometimes, or even a little dull sometimes? Or why can I get so easily distracted, not by ministry, but by hiking, or is the garbage going to be picked up, or why did they just empty one can last week instead of the other one? You know, I mean, how come in that process? Well, I think one of the reasons that it's progressive now is because it keeps us coming back to the well. If it was one and done, we might be one and done. But the fact that it's progressive touches that transform us, keep us going back to the well. I was trying to think of just some word pictures that make this make sense to us. It's a good thing that it's not full intensity. I was thinking of the sun. Just our natural sun, though there's great metaphor there. But our natural sun, in its right, you know, gazed at in the right way, enjoyed in the right way, is warming. It's tanning. It's mood changing. And it's sight giving. When we have proper relationship with the natural sun, it's those four things. But if we're cavalier and uncontrolled in our relationship to the sun, it's overheating, it's burning, it's cancer causing, and it's blinding, right? Well, that's the same thing in a sense with God. We don't have perfect apparatus. There's still aspects of sin that linger in our lives. It's just true. Our spirit is perfect. Our spirit is perfect, and that's why when they said, oh my gosh, I saw the face of the Lord and I lived. I think it's because they saw him in visions. They saw him in the sense of their spirit and therefore lived. In any event, God is so holy, holy, holy. And we know that there's some intensity about that we're just not prepared for. No one in human life had ever been more intimate with the Lord Jesus as a friend than John the Apostle. He walked with him. He was part of the three, but most would say that he was the most intimate associate that Jesus had was John. He leaned on his breast in that Eastern custom as they reclined around the table. He was part of the transfiguration and saw Jesus transfigured before him. And yet when he gets a revelation of the resurrection Jesus in his full-on glory, this is his friend. His best friend. What does it say? It says he fell on his face as a dead man. Now that doesn't mean that God was against him. In fact, Jesus condescended and he bends over and he says, John, it's I. Don't be afraid. Stand up. But it's overwhelmingly intense, his glory. His glory, holy, 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 is both happy-making and tear-filling. And how would I describe that? This is one of the hardest things that I have to do or one of the things I get questioned the most deeply on, and I have the hardest time articulating, is, well, God is love. He's just love, and it's all gentle. I said, no, the truth is he is love, but his love is also potentially a consuming fire. God is love. God is a consuming fire. God is love is a consuming fire. He has raging passions. Here would be another way that the Bible says it in the book of Romans. Behold both the kindness and severity of your God. Now, does that mean that he's multiple personality? He's both loving and good and he's mean? That isn't the point. He's one burning, passionate fire of love. Okay? He's one burning, passionate fire of love. But now let me draw your attention to an illustration. Metals, when they're smelted, the reason they're smelted is because they have impurities, right? They have something called dross. And so we smelt them in a fire in order to get rid of dross. Here's how I like to describe it. Let's say you're smelting gold, but gold can also have dross. And you're smelting it in the fire of God's love, in the fire of the passionate heart of God. The point is that if you approach that love in the right way, it will purify you as gold. But you approach that love as dross, and it will consume you. It will consume you. That same holiness can manifest in two different ways. That same holiness manifests in two different ways. Therefore, it's with a reverence that we come before him and say, holy, holy, holy. I mean, people talk about it all the time at men's group, their friends, their co-workers, particularly God. When I get to heaven, I'm going to have a few words with God. I've got a few things I'm going to say to him. I'm like, and they're like, oh my goodness, you don't know the fear of the Lord. It's like, no, change that. Change that. It's okay to ask him some questions, say some things were really confusing down there. But no, the last thing you're going to do is just go up there and give him a piece of your mind. He is loving. And the fact is that we approach him with dross in our life. It's called sin, right? But we approach him, and it's in gazing upon the beauty of the Lord that we feel, in a sense, the pain of him. Though it's a good pain. We feel both the purifying of our heart while at the same time he's stripping away the negative. And that's part of that gazing upon the beauty of the Lord. Because there's, even though our spirits are perfect, there's still sin alive in our mortal members. I wanted you to think about it for a second. In the garden, God used to be with his people, right? He brought to Adam all the different animals so that he could name them, right? That's in Genesis, I think, early in chapter 2. But he was physically present with them, walked with them in the garden in the cool of the day. We have the sense that that was his habit as well, right? And then that time when he made Eve and presented her, like the father of a bride presenting her to the groom, and he presents Eve, physically present, and they were seeing his face. Do you know what happened after the fall in the garden when they were tempted and tricked by Satan? We no longer have references to seeing his face. Because sin under sin, God said in Exodus chapter 33, and I think it's verse 22, he said, "Now no man shall see my face and live." And the reason we won't live is because of those sinful and stained parts within us. And so we can't see the Lord full on. We see him through the subdued glory of Jesus in earth and flesh, right? But no longer do we have references to seeing the Lord face to face after that time. In fact, when he came for his daily walk, he walked in the garden in the cool of the day. You know what it says after they sinned? It says they didn't see him face to face. They heard him. They heard him coming, and what did they do? They hid themselves. But now turn in your Bible, if you would, if you have it open. How does it end? You could say that the whole redemptive history is to take us from seeing the Lord to having that stripped away, the ability to see the Lord. And his whole redemptive process is so he ultimately wants to get us to the place, and I just talked about it, where through glorification or through justification and sanctification and glorification, the realm of saving our spirit, the realm of saving our soul, the realm of saving our body, have been saved, are being saved, and will be saved when that work takes place. The ultimate thing of heaven will be Revelation chapter 22, verse 4, and it says what? And they will see his face again forever. They'll see his face again forever. You could say, you could make the poetic picture or the metaphor or the symbolism that the whole redemptive history is to go back to being able to see God face to face. Feel like I'm struggling a little bit to make the point, so let me try just one more thing. One of the reasons intimacy with God, one of the things of pursuing intimacy gets hard for us, again, is because the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 12, it tells us we see in the mirror dimly. I referred to it earlier. He says, for right now we see in a mirror dimly. It's not that pleasing to look at because there's distortions and it's not super clear and not always sure what you're looking at. But then one day we'll see face to face. How did I put it in my notes? These meager notes. It's like, yeah, I would seek the Lord for intimacy if I could just see him in an open vision. I would love to seek the Lord for intimacy if I could just hear his audible voice. I'd love to seek the Lord for intimacy if I could just go to sleep and have vivid dreams of him or be carried away into the third heaven to have these dramatic encounters with him, to have a wrestling match all night with God like Jacob had. Gideon had an encounter with the angel of the Lord, different ones. Remember Isaiah? Yeah, I'd love that if a seraph came and touched my lips with a burning coal and purified the speech for the rest of the life. But the truth of the matter is that we see dimly, and we see in the cleft of a rock, and that's partly for our protection. But the point is that even though we see dimly and even though we see in a cleft of the rock, when Moses cried out and he said, "Lord, show me your glory," the Lord did condescend. He says, "No, I can't. You can't see my face." But he says, "Here, I'm going to hide you away in a cleft of a rock." Clearly a picture of in Christ. In Christ, you can gaze upon me. But I'm going to put you in the cleft of the rock. And as I pass by and say my name, I'm going to cover myself and shield you from the glory so that it becomes glory to you like unto the sun, where it's warming and where it's mood enhancing and where it gives you sight to see. Because if I don't shelter it somewhat with my hand, it will blind you, it will burn you, it will destroy you. You have to take it in measured bits. And again, I think part of the reason for that is that it keeps us going back to the well. I wanted to try just one final thing in closing. It might seem like a humble offering, but I really think that this, because I wanted to try and get it down to very practical, what is it to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord? What is it to try and seek the Lord in intimacy? What does that really mean practically, to have intimacy with the Lord? Well, I've tried to write on that subject recently. A big part of it is singing related to ideas of Him, and that's part of it. But I don't play an instrument, and I don't often have access to all the right songs. So I found another way that is pursuing the beauty of the Lord primarily through the scriptures. I stumbled upon a verse recently that said, "From everlasting to everlasting, Thou art God." And I said, "Lord, that's beautiful, because that's a description of You, and You're the beautiful God. So that has to be, there's beauty in that sentiment. There's beauty in that construction. There's beauty in that idea of everlasting to everlasting, You are God." And I forget the exact reference. I want to say that it's Isaiah. But I just stopped and I thought, okay, how do I do this, Lord? I want to gaze upon Your beauty. I want to just take this attribute of You. I want to think about this thing from You. And I want to use it in my life that You could beautify me with the sentiment of this idea. And it just goes something like this. And this is kind of my closing. I don't think it'll take very long. But I do this. I just want to say, in pursuing intimacy with the Lord, I do something like what I'm about to do now. It must be at least 100 times a week, with different ideas, different scriptures, different thoughts. But I think this is the essence of pursuing intimacy with the Lord. So you take that thought about the Lord. Heavenly Father, what an amazing thing to think that from everlasting, and I'm trying to show you what I would do as if I was in my own prayer closet. Heavenly Father, that what an amazing thing that from everlasting to everlasting, You are God. And everlasting isn't a period. Everlasting is everlasting. So there was never a time. It must mean, Lord, that there was never a time when You were not. There was never a time when You were not. And the truth is, Lord, that unless there's a God like You, where never there was a time that You were not, is the only way that this world can make sense to me. That there's something completely holy and utterly outside this world. Lord, that You created the heavens and the earth. Man, that is no stumbling block for me. That is no stumbling block for me. I honor You, as Your word does hundreds of times, for being our Creator God. Because I realize it's the only way that something can come forth, as if something preceded it, and You preceded everything. I don't marvel anymore when I think about man. What is man that Thou art mindful of him? I love myself and I love my friends. But when I think about the fact that You are from everlasting everlasting, I get where David says in the Psalms, "What is man that Thou art mindful of him?" Heavenly Father, I want to see more and more. Beautify me. Put your beauty upon me. Not that I can ever be uncreated, but put your beauty upon me so that at least I could peer into your perspective. Into the perspective of the everlasting, to everlasting God. That I could at least gaze upon the perspective, how you think about things, knowing the end from the beginning. Knowing the end from the beginning. Lord, what may I never make decisions. May I never try and pastor or parent or husband or neighbor without having some sense of your eternal mindset. Heavenly Father, you know the end from the beginning. You are from everlasting to everlasting. You know fads and trends that have yet to come along. And that's all the more important reason that I do not want to be bogged down and have my life dominated by trends and fads that last maybe for a decade when you are an eternal God. I want to be dominated by your perspectives. I want to be dominated by the style and by the fads that are considered forever settled in heaven and not by the fads and the trends of this life. Lord, I have so little time for pop psychologists. I have so little time for pop theologians. I have so little time for pop philosophers. When I can go to you, Father, when I can go to you, who sees everything panoramically and perfectly and without the limits of time, Father, I want to be governed by your eternal rule, by your eternal word, by your forever settled in heaven word. In real chest, Lord God, the kings of this earth, my own president, whom I strive to honor and pray for, so I don't mean him any ill will, Lord. But just know that in my heart, my president is nothing more than a pawn before you. Because there is in reality only one king, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And there's nothing that man can do, so why should I be fettered? Why should I be shook? There's nothing that man can do. You hold the checkmate on every move of governor and king. And your plan will prevail. Father, again, you who are everlasting to everlasting, grant me to see from a higher and wider plane, that I might actually see truly, that I might see. Let me be, and I'll close with this, Father, let me be so heavenly minded that I am some earthly good. Father, I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I see that as seeing in a mirror dimly. That's seeing in a mirror dimly.